It's time for every American. It's time for every American to enjoy the freedom.
What are the major themes in your work, and why do you keep returning to them?
The theme maybe is the, I was remembering the thing about a German exhibition I did, which they determined the title to be Food, Sex, and TV, which I thought was sort of a good way of Germanic simplification or something, but those might be the subject matter. Constant subject matter ideas. A figure certainly is always present. I think more of structural ideas that might have to do with a text relationship or a structure that's linguistic or language-like. Figure field differences as a structural idea, so maybe those, and sequencing would be real continuity. Does that answer it, kind of?
I think so. Why do you like to use text in your work?
It may not be true of all photographs, but it seems to me the things that I do do require that, I put it differently, actually. It seems to me that photographs per se can't have meaning unless it's a formal meaning, which I'm not interested in formal meaning, so it's necessary for me to either contextualize the pictures in some way or to use language or text to force a confluence of things that otherwise would be scattered, something like that.
I love you, but I'm really worn down.
Like a round stone in my stream bed.
But clean.
How you use identity in your work, you seem to play with the concept of identity, male, female identity, the identity of individuals that get merged with the identities or visual images of other individuals that obscures their identity, that kind of thing.
Right. Property of, let's say, folding an identity into another individual on a fictional level or on a temporary level, I think is a fascinating thing to me, and only a thing that's available in fantasy or in art. One might try to do that in reality, but you can't accomplish it. Excuse me. So the mixing of genders isn't something necessarily that produces androgyny, which we think of as a sort of beautiful thing, but more often a kind of strange mixture that's not, where the confluence is not so androgynous as it is bisexual, maybe, or something like that. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about the writing of the conversations between the people, the he-she things, where the very interesting things to me in writing it was to simply change the he to the she and see how that absolutely changes the whole character of the conversation. Because when a man asks when a man and then a woman ask the same question, it seems to me to have completely different connotation.
I'm beginning to feel uncomfortable with you sometimes.
Which sometimes?
When you're drinking and acting.
Is your body telling you these things?
I don't know what you mean.
Are they physical feelings?
Of magazine imagery, how do you balance banality with eroticism?
It seems to me that the choice of material is basically erotic, or, you know, having sensual overtone, certainly, and in combination does become banal, or is diffused to some extent by certain combinations of that, or at least the mixture between those two things. I would be interested in trying to find.
I think critics have often found your work confusing in that respect, because they don't know exactly what attitude you're taking toward the media image, especially images of women. How do you respond to that?
It's maybe not, one doesn't choose to do exactly, you know, what you do, but I have evolved into a state of mind where I'm convinced that what I am doing is interesting to me. I can make the material more clear one way or the other, but I prefer to make it what seems to me to be the most effective way, and is always there of interpretation. But
So do you think that men and women will see your work differently?
Yeah, I would. I mean, we don't want to overgeneralize too much, but I would think that is the case, although I've had various opinions from the critical community that doesn't seem to always be, you know, one gender or another. Which leads me to believe that, you know, not always a clear way to distinguish.
What is your purpose in restructuring the TV image, reforming it, reordering it, playing it back against itself?
I think the basic idea would be to help it to destroy itself somehow, or try to defuse its sense of power or whatever. So it, to make a joke out of it, or to try to show its idiocy as a way of defusing it, something like that.
Mm-hmm. And then you almost invariably use text along with that, and are you trying to do the same thing with the text that you're doing with the images then? I was thinking of
Reagan. The Reagan, me too. I was thinking that the both of those things are authentic. That is to say, the text is actual and the television image is actual, but obviously they don't, they're coming at different times, so that what he's not saying, or what I leave out, is what makes what he is saying so ridiculous. Huh? So that is a way of simply tampering with it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Hard to, without seeing it, it's hard to understand that, but yeah.
Can you talk more generally about your attitude toward television and how people are affected by it?
Yeah, I don't know that, I mean, there is a great deal of influence and let's say an acknowledgement of influence by sociology and what have you as to the negative effect on it. I'm not so concerned with that as I am with how it tends to replace conversation, how it certainly tends to replace reading, and how it absolutely cuts off dialogue. And all of those things are important, I think, for the more advanced the culture is, the more necessary those things are. And obviously, that's not the way we're proceeding, you know, now.
Mm-hmm. You created an installation that used television images and plastered them all over a mannequin and all over the walls. What was the idea behind that?
Well, I guess to suggest in some way that it is everywhere, and every object that we come into contact with, or every idea is almost a television idea now, or some kind of photographic idea, so that it's not a complex idea, but to suggest that everything, including us, you know, the mannequin as a symbol for us, is television or is television image. And maybe the point is that you can't escape from that.
Appropriating images from the media long before postmodernism ever had a name. How do you think about your work in terms of postmodernism?
The direct answer to the question, I think, would go that it's not who does something first necessarily. It's who becomes identified with that, what idea, process, or invention, or whatever. So what happened, which I have no remorse about or whatever, but what happened is that critics began to invent, in the art photography realm, critics began to invent the idea of postmodernist strategies or whatever around the work of five or six people. By the time they did that, I'm already through that phase, in a sense. I mean, I've already gotten out of so-called appropriation, whatever it was that was interesting to me about it. So that the point is, I think, that it's got to have critical support and critical attention paid to it, and you have to have a group of people who are working in some some way that's confluent to one another rather than, you know, an individual. So it's an interesting question, though.
What interests you most at the moment?
At the moment? I suppose the working with these three-dimensional relief, you know, sculptural kinds of things seem to me to have enough potential to last me, you know, a good year or whatever. There's just a lot to be done there, both in terms of the content of that kind of work and the manipulation of that. What you looked at is really the first layer of what I think will turn into very manipulated and very surrealistic kinds of figures rather than these stereotypes which I showed you, and certainly larger pieces, so that these, you know, maybe a room would be filled with these individuals. I mean, all the walls and all the panels, everything.
You've always seemed to gravitate toward sculptural forms, or at least you've been doing that for a long time. What led you to this interest in manipulating the actual magazine image into sculpture?
As you you noted earlier, this directly related to that feminist suntan piece. It's also directly related to earlier work, which you may recall, of the TV dinners and things like that, which were also molded. But mostly, I think it's always been for me that the photograph, you know, in its kind of natural state, is flat and small. So I've always been interested to make it larger, that is to say, make it life-size, and to make it dimensional. Certainly not three-dimensional, because that's something else, but to force it out of a strict two-dimensional, flat, drab surface.
Can you define what you mean by satire?
Well, strictly, no. It's a serious joke, satire, and I mean, unlike parody maybe, but it is always directed at something that's serious or some person that's serious, and attempts to make you see through that hypocrisy or something like that, I think.
A chauvinist.
Chauvinist. Everybody's a chauvinist. I'm probably a good example of one. I don't think you escape that. You temper it, maybe, or you try to use it in ways that are still productive and not negative.
A social commentator.
Well, I like that label also. That's a goal, right, rather than maybe what I accomplish, but most everything I find myself involved in does have a socio or cultural context, and I do comment.
Gorilla.
It's guerrilla.
Guerrilla.
Gorilla. Well, I've used that word or that label to describe my activities, especially at an earlier time, and I do admire the tactics that are involved in that. Of course, those tactics can be applied to good or to evil, but going into a situation, making a very small move that makes a very big effect, is essentially a guerrilla tactic, which I think is effective.
Mm-hmm. A Dadaist.
Well, the Dada and Surrealist visual arts are the most interesting to me in the history of art, and I think they very fitting for my temperament, in the sense of being interested in the random. I'm very interested in the accidental. I'm very fatalistic. I like humor. I like surprises, and surprises, and surprises. Thank you.
love you, but I'm really worn down.
Like a round stone in my stream bed.
But not as clean. I love you, but I'm really worn down.
Like a round stone in my stream bed.
But not as clean. Oh, wait a minute.
Can we go to?
Yeah.
Okay, go for it. Oh, I'm
going. We're not recording
yet. Are we recording?
Well, yeah, we are recording.
Oh, we are?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm confused about my life and what I'm doing.
You are teaching art and you don't know how to...
Maybe.
You are making pictures and you don't know why.
I suppose.
You are married and you don't want to be.
Yes.
You are having this affair and you feel guilty.
And stupid.
And you are much too young for any of it.
Did you want us to do that he-she bit? I'm confused about my life and what I'm doing.
You're teaching art and you don't know how to do it.
Maybe.
You are making pictures and you don't know why.
I suppose.
You are married and you don't want to be.
Yes.
You are having this affair and you feel guilty.
And stupid.
And you are much too young for any of it.
I'm beginning to feel uncomfortable with you sometimes.
Which sometimes?
When you're drinking and acting funny.
Body telling you these things?
I don't know what you mean.
Are they physical feelings as opposed to intellectual or emotional?
Lately, you don't seem like you to me.
Did you know that your tears are bright yellow like your urine?
It's my vitamins.
I'm sorry, I couldn't see the rest of it.
I'm beginning to feel uncomfortable with you sometimes.
Which times?
When you're drinking and acting funny.
Is your body telling you these things?
I don't know what you mean.
Are they physical feelings as opposed to intellectual or emotional?
Lately, you don't seem like you to me.
Did you know that your tears are bright yellow, like your urine?
It's my vitamins.